Hello and welcome to my interview today. I'm excited to share with you a gentleman named Stephan Neff. He is a doctor from New Zealand and also an author and a speaker and a recovering alcoholic on a mission that he is going to be sharing with you today. I'm very excited for you to meet him and bring him in from New Zealand. So with no further ado, here is Dr. Stephan Neff. Hello, Stephan. There we go.
Hello. Hello, Danielle.
Oh, thank you so much for joining me today. I'm very excited to share you with my audience, a doctor from New Zealand. Very exciting. It's Tuesday where you're at, and it's Monday where I'm at. That's just really kind of a very cool thing.
That's right. I come from the future.
I love that. That's awesome. Yeah, my nephew is in the Antarctic right now, and it's also Tuesday by him.
Well, very much so. Very much so. Goodness gracious. This love affair with the penguins, we need to talk about that. Antarctica, come on. It's a bit cold there.
It's not really about that. He is a weatherman and he's there on a
summer. I see. Okay, he has got an excuse. Fair call.
Yes, he does. Well, you are a doctor and you live in New Zealand. So give us a little bit of history. Were you born and raised in New Zealand? And why did you pick the kind of a doctor that you are? Yeah. As I told you earlier, I have a difficult time pronouncing the kind of doctor you are. I'm going to tell on myself right here, because that's why I do this live. This is authentic. This is me. And hopefully my voice doesn't sound funny, because I'm going to confess that to everyone here. I got Invisaligns recently, and so I just changed them today to new ones. So if I sound a little funny, please forgive me. By tomorrow, I'll probably be sounding fine again.
But I love it, Danielle. I love it, Danielle, that you're carving out with that and that you're saying, yes, come on. It is. I'm working on myself, literally. Yes. Yeah, the renovations are happening. And that's exactly. Brilliant. That's what we do today, you know. Yes. And that ties in nicely in a moment. So I come back to your teeth there, because they play a big role in my youth as well. So going back, who am I? I'm Stephan Neff. I'm a consultant anesthetist. In America, you would call it anesthesiologist.
Anesthesiologist. The other one I couldn't say. I tried. He's a doctor.
That's right. No, anesthetist. We're anesthetists. I would say we've got a bit longer education compared with an anesthesiologist, but ultimately we are much of a muchness. So I actually was raised in Germany, and that is of relevance, because Germany is a gorgeous place. Gorgeous with, you've got lovely bread and lovely meat products, and there's so many lovely things, chocolate, you name it, but there's also alcohol. We are very good in our wines, our champagnes, or champagne-like things. Our beers are world famous. Schnapps, oh God, we'll live on that. So, and therefore, being born in 1966, I was a young man in the 80s. Well, everyone was drinking. My heroes were drinking. I didn't have a great childhood. There were certainly no male role models there. So I looked around to find some, and there was Mel Gibson in Lethal Weapon. There was Bruce Willis in Die Hard. Okay.
Oh, wow.
All the anti-heroes. Okay. So, you wake up in the morning, cough your lungs out, have a cigarette, stand naked there and have a piss whilst you're swigging down a beer. Okay, I can do that. I can do that.
Goodness.
Yeah, that sounds like a good moral model. Yeah. Honestly, that was me. I give it. I tell you, and it is. It is. Germany can be quite restrictive and have a lot of norms, and so maybe to have this freedom in your mind, at least, to be this rebel. I mean, that's what every teenager wants. He wants to rebel against the generation before him, and that is normal. That went back 3,000 years. That was that will be a curse. That will be there forever for every next generation. So
well,
I was
just
they different.
Have to find themselves. We have to find ourselves. We're raised with our parents, and they teach us things, and then we have to deconstruct our childhood in some form to own what we want to be.
Now that is a beautiful way how to put it. Of course, no teenager actually does that. We say, "Oh, that's all shit for you. Who are you? What do you know?" Well, I was not different there. So yeah, anyhow, I made up my own rules, and well, these rules were a bit tainted, may I say, to start off with. But also, when I was 13, I was attacked, wrong place, wrong time. A gang had a go at me, and I ended up with basically no front teeth. And that as a 13-year-old, you and in Germany they don't do permanent kind of stuff until you're 18 because you're still growing. Everything goes. So therefore, I had this kind of the temporary kind of shit in my mouth, and needless to say, there was not much smiling in my. I was running around like someone who has got no teeth in and keep the mouth together. So that was that. So that a big there. But also, what I didn't know is I had a massive PTSD going, and because I brought a ringleader behind bars, so and he swore a revenge after 3 years when he got out. So I had 3 years to get my shit together, and so I did.
That's
So
scary.
I, it was, but at the same token, I was training 4 hours a day in martial arts with the police, and it was actually, it was a very focused time, a very focused time, but on my body. So I became this lean fighting machine, yet up there, nothing happened. There was no self-improvement, that no one knew about that at that time. There was no system in place to help me. And so my mind went into that survival mode and it never got out. So I basically became the fighter, which made me very good because if you're hypervigilant, you're constantly aware of your surrounding, you're ready to go for anything at any time, which is really good when you're a doctor. You don't get caught out with anything, you know? It is, and that made me then later made me a very good anesthetist because the anesthetists, so anesthesiologists, we are really sort of the special forces of medicine. When the shit hits the fan, the anesthetist is getting called. Doesn't matter if this is a difficult birth, if this is a very sick child in emergency department, if this is a major trauma, if this is a mass incident, a major shooting or something like that, COVID, intensive care, chronic pain, acute pain, you name it. We get called when other doctors don't know what to do, when they're at the end of their wisdom, we get brought in. And so that I liked that. I liked that aspect of my job, because here I was the knight in shining armor, the special forces, yeah, and the cool guy coming in,
I
and
can
I
see that,
became.
especially out of after the trauma you had to find your value, because trauma rips our value away, and so you found your value then in being a doctor.
Did I know that? No,
No.
that all happened
No,
on
trauma
such
doesn't
a
teach
deep
us things.
level.
It affects
No,
us. It doesn't
no.
teach us, it affects us.
No, it was so deep, and this became one of my drivers, and that became this kind of knight in shining armor, protecting the innocent and the victims, is all quite pretty. But if that is all what you do, and if that is all what you focus on, this is the surefire way to get burned out, and that is what, unfortunately, what I experienced then later on in my life when I became an anesthetist, but also specialized in chronic pain management. And that was in various countries, but here in New Zealand, there is not much money around in the healthcare system. And certainly to do all those things that could be done for someone who is suffering, there was not the money. On the contrary, there was a movement to say, now let's get rid of these chronically ill people from our books, no matter where they go. So there was that. And I became sort of the fighter for my patients. But I was well, yeah, idiot, because ultimately it is this aeroplane scenario, and the oxygen came down. I made sure the oxygen was on everyone else, and I didn't take it myself, okay? So I ended up being nastily burned out and relying on alcohol. Alcohol was, when I was young, didn't really play much of a role until I came to university, because I was busy fighting in my mind. I was busy training. I was constantly out there, And then I changed towns, went to university, and suddenly there were two things. A, alcohol in abundance. Well, three things actually. Alcohol in abundance, freedom. My parents were no longer around. I was on my own, and there were girls. And put that together, that had an interesting effect on me. So, but also it was the first time where I actually could relax. The alcohol allowed me to relax. I didn't have to be the fighter anymore. I could just, after a beer or
Yeah,
two or
fighting's
five,
exhausting.
this constant hypervigilance. And so it was beautiful. So alcohol served me well, at a
Until it
time.
didn't.
Correct. Spot on. It was a really good friend. And it had a lot of benefits for me, I really must say. I was intrinsically quite shy, and there I was disinhibited,
I
could
can't
talk to a
imagine you
girl.
being shy.
Oh, please,
No
please.
way. You
Oh, yeah.
shy? Oh, wow.
No,
I
no, no, I
cannot
worked.
even imagine that.
I worked on that, okay? For me, public speaking would have been, oh, God, no, because I had no value in myself. I was insecure. I was. Oh God, I was a wreck, an emotional wreck with no self-worth. I mean, I was hard work. And I knew that, and so I tried to make up for it in being the fighter, okay, but also being this big mouth, being this kind of, oh, I must have been a real dick, okay? So as a young man, I must have been hard work, but somehow the girls liked it. So it was just weird. When I look back, it's just such a mess. But that was then. And it is, I never learned to deal with negative emotions. And I think that was the key thing. I never learned about all those things that are important, creating an atmosphere where you grow resilient, creating self-love, doing things that matter in your life, so therefore you can build up your self-esteem and your picture of yourself as something positive, not as
Yeah, so
something
you
like
buried
you.
yourself in the bottle then, right?
No, I buried myself first at work and then in the bottle.
And
So
then
I
where did
was
that
just,
lead you to? That led you down a really dark path, didn't it?
well, burnout, and well, sooner or later, I must say, life was not easy for me. A lot of shit happened in my life. There were
Yeah,
many
sounds like
traumas.
it.
There were many traumas over the years, and because I had not learned to deal with that, I relied more heavily on working far too much. And then when I could no longer distract myself with work, I then went straight for the vodka and tried to get as numb as I can to finally allow myself to crash. And this kind of lack of ability to look after myself came really to a crushing end. I mean, I was a high functioning alcoholic. I was a man. I never fell foul of the police. I never had really anything like that happening. But at the same token, I
Praise
was
God for
com not true.
that.
I was committing suicide in installments, basically in over the years. And that and depression became stronger and stronger. I didn't see any way out of this life. There were many lies that my brain told me, that depression told me, and I believed them, that there is no hope, that I'm worth nothing, that I would be better off not being here, my family would be better off, all this kind of rubbish. And but when you're in the darkness, you feel that. You don't just know it, you feel it. So it's on a very different level. And therefore it is so strong. You believe that there is no help out there, so you don't even bother. And you're also ashamed. You're full of shame and guilt. So therefore, oh no, I'm a doctor. I can't possibly admit to all that shit. So here you are, you're
The
living this kind of
pressure
double
on
life.
top of
Yeah,
that, that
absolutely.
pressure of,
Absolutely.
I can't admit that because I'm a doctor. What will they think of me? Because you're just crawling out from all that lack of self-worth, and then that just piles another layer of it on top of it. That's just,
Exactly.
oh, I can feel the pain myself. I can feel it myself. So how did you come out of that? How did you finally get out of that horrendous pressure and pain and hiding and all of that big mess? How did you find your way out and how you're thriving now? You're doing amazing things now.
The simple. I needed the help of a strong team, and that team was in fact 2.5 hours away from me in Auckland, in the form of a rehab hospital. The Capri Hospital is no longer there in this in the gorgeous way that it was, but that was my rescue. My wife had admitted me behind my back and basically had called in one night when I was really down and out and crying, sobbing in the garage, drunk like a skunk. She had called my boss from work, and he saw me in all my glory, so to speak. And yeah, so he
It's like
was.
I feel that pain. I feel that pain.
And it was brutal. And I can vaguely remember that discussion that night. Next morning, I woke up and I thought, "What the hell happened?" And the door opened, and there was my wife, and my two children came in, lay down with me in bed, and said, gave me a cuddle, and said, "Hey, this Friday, this was a Wednesday morning by then, this Friday you're gonna go to the hospital. You will be admitted for 4 weeks. And it's all cleared with your work. They know there is no trouble there." My wife had cancelled all my private commitments, my private clinics, all my work that I had been doing around the country, and said that's it.
Wow,
And
that
so,
is amazing how they delivered that information. Because love
with
heals.
love.
They came in
Oh yeah.
and
Oh yeah.
cuddled you
Oh
and
yeah.
made provision for you in
Oh
your
yeah.
work and surrounded you with love that you have this, you need help, but we love you and going to love you through that. Wow. I just want to pause and just savor that for a minute. That
That was,
love heals and that love entered into your life and ushered you out. That's just, that's part of
My
why I'm that
fat.
lady on the internet who loves you. Danielle Brunock from daniellebrunock.com. Love yourself from survive to thrive. That lady on the internet who loves you because love is what carries us out. I mean, if they had come in a different way,
I would have
it could have,
automatically fought. I would have been a fighter.
it would have
Instead,
played out differently, but oh, and
they
you,
completely disarmed me, absolutely
yes.
disarmed me with love. And I think that
Yes.
is the key for anyone out there, for anyone who maybe lives with someone who is an alcoholic or an addict. What I recommend you to do is
Love
hate the addiction, but love the addict.
Yes.
Because the person underneath there is so much in this person. If you can assist this person to ask the right questions and get the right
Yes.
help,
Right.
and if you see the transformation happening in front of you, it is the most wow moment in your life. And that is happening to so many of us who finally allow ourselves to admit that we are powerless over alcohol, powerless over our drugs, powerless over our eating disorder or gambling addiction, all the various addictions that are out there. The moment you actually you allow yourself to accept that you're powerless, that is where it all starts.
Yeah, I
And
have to
on
climb
that
over
day,
that shame because there's a lie of shame that needing help is shameful. And
absolutely.
it's like,
And
no, it
yeah.
is not shameful to need help. It takes
No.
courage to ask for help. And you're
Absolutely.
strong if you ask for help. I'm going to stop here. Who's listening? It takes courage to ask for help. You are strong. If you need help, you ask for help. It takes courage, and we commend you. There is no shame in asking for
Absolutely.
help. Look
Absolutely.
at Dr. Stephan Neff here. And Dr. Stephen, you said you say on your website and that you live the most beautiful life. Can you illustrate that for us in a way so we can imagine what you mean by that, the most beautiful life?
I automatically have to smile
I
when
know
I
you
think
just
about
lit up. You just lit up. You just
that.
lit up when I said that. I just saw the light coming from your face.
Well, to start off with, there's no more hiding. There's no more hiding.
Wow.
I don't hide that I am hungover. I don't hide that I'm thinking of alcohol. I don't hide that I'm buying the alcohol. I don't hide that I'm drinking the alcohol, and I don't hide that I'm drunk. I was busy. I was a full-time hider, you know?
Yeah.
So all that shit is gone out of my life. I can actually look into the mirror and say, wow, you achieved so much. I am actually nowadays proud of myself, not proud of the achievement in my job. I was always proud of that. And if people ask me, who are you? And I said, I'm an anaesthetist and a pain physician. And I said, no, Stefan, you, I mean, you yourself. And I said, what do you mean? I've just told you I'm an anaesthetist and a pain physician. I
What
was
was that
nothing.
second thing you said?
A pain physician, a pain physician, a chronic pain management. But I could not define myself in any other way. I was an empty shell. And that was the big difference. So therefore nowadays, I am proud of who I am, not what letters I've got after my name. So my biggest achievements are ultimately that I have started the healing process by taking active steps, by listening to others. I surrounded myself with a power team where I was the dumbest person in the team. So I had mentors, I had psychologists, I had a psychiatrist, I had a nutritionist. And at various times over the last 8 years, that team changed a little bit. But ultimately, I always was the dumbest person because I wanted to learn. I was finally ready to learn and ready to learn about myself. And that was the cool thing. So by doing so, I peeled off the onion layer by layer, and I found some rather stinky things under some of the layers, but I dealt with them. And therefore, with every healing, I felt the pain of the trauma, I felt the pain of the healing, but then I could wrap that up and put that baby to bed. And then I could peel the next layer. And then there we are again. But it was this journey of growth, this journey of dealing with my past, dealing with issues of abandonment, bullying, the gang assault, the PTSD. I only realized really that I had PTSD 2, 3 years ago. So for all that time, there was a hidden driver of my emotions, which then resulted in my reactions rather than actions. So it was always in response to the outer world or to my fucked up core beliefs and emotions. It was always I was responding rather than what I do now, being proactive, putting habits into place, daily habits that actually allow me to set a foundation upon which I can then, do my day's work or do my growth or focus on my relationships or whatever there is. But that foundation is as simple as that I look after myself. I actually try to get some sleep. I don't burn the candle anymore, or too much anymore, on both ends. I'm still, that's my biggest vice. I love
Well, you
work. I
don't burn
love.
the candle the same way you did before.
No, correct, correct.
So you can
Well, no,
definitely say that.
in the past that was the candle and there was fire everywhere, okay? So let's be clear about that.
It's like
Nowadays
everybody
it's only
burns
on
the
two
candle at
ends.
both ends sometimes because we're
Well,
human, okay?
that's right. That's right. No, Danielle, it is ultimately today I'm actually living in the present. Right now, I am really truly enjoying talking to you. So right now I feel that. I feel my bottom sitting on the chair. I've got a glass of coffee here and I love with you. So I enjoy this moment. In the past, I would have already thought, oh, I must go to work and then later on I must do that. I would have not been in the moment. I was either in the future or I was in the past. And neither of that exists if you think about it. Okay? So it's actually stupid. I was living imaginary lives and that was bullshit. So nowadays I actually live for the moment. And let's rephrase that. I'm not a dreamer and just say, hey, peace and it's all fine. No. I
You
live right now.
appreciate the moment.
Absolutely. And I cherish it for the privilege and for the gift that this moment is. I get every day in my job as an anaesthetist, I get reminded that not all of us will grow old. Not all of us will have a body that they can rely on. There will be shit will hit the fan. There is no doubt about it. There's this, you will get depression. You will get some trauma that you didn't see. You will be in financial problems. There is no question about that. That will happen. But nowadays, I don't catastrophize about it but I'm actually putting the foundations in so that I am strong enough to deal with the challenges that life inevitably throws at me. And that makes me no longer a victim. That makes me no longer
Right.
reactive,
Makes you a
but it makes,
victor, a victorious soul.
yeah, exactly. This makes me a man who is able to be there for myself. As such, I deal very differently nowadays with challenges. Like, what was it? Saturday, I was interviewed by another host, and we were chatting, and I was animated, and suddenly my coffee fell out of my hands and poured into my lap. So there was, I know, that was all life, and we were there. And can you imagine? Me as a younger man, I would have been petrified, I would have been red, and I would have been angry, and I would have been, oh my God. And the only thing I could do in that show, my host was terrified about what was happening. I just laughed. And we made a big joke
I
out of
hope
it.
you
Make a
didn't hurt
learning.
yourself, though.
No, that's
Okay,
lukewarm or
good,
cold coffee.
good,
That's why
good.
we anesthetists drink cold coffee. There you
Okay.
go. Big lesson to learn. Not
Okay.
that we like to do wet shorts contests or something like that.
No.
But it was that kind of thing. That is
Yes.
my life now.
Oh,
I'm no
learning, being
longer.
able to laugh at yourself is a
Exactly.
precious gift.
Is it
Oh, I
not?
remember when I could never do that. And now I get joy out of it, like just cracking up, like, I cannot believe I did that. Are you freaking serious?
Exactly right. And at work, I, as much as I hand it out, I get it back. So we have got a very sarcastic teamwork at work, and it's brilliant. We're all sort of the same age. We all have gone through hell and back. And so that is, oh, we're taking a mick out of each other, and it's beautiful. And when you're on the receiving end, there is not, oh God, I'm a failure. They're making jokes of me because after all, I was bullied. So in the past, so this could have, in
Well, that's a
theory,
trauma
anything.
reaction, and
Of
you dealt
course.
with the trauma, and so you don't have the trauma reaction anymore. So
Exactly.
you did the
So.
work, and that's something to pause here now to our listeners. If you
Exactly.
want a beautiful life, you need to do the work.
Oh,
It
yes, man.
takes work. You need to
Oh,
peel the
yes.
layers, do the work, and you can have a
Oh,
beautiful
yes.
life. Well,
Absolutely.
your transformation, which is profound, has led you to a mission. What is your mission that you are on? Share your mission with our audience.
To make this world a little bit better, one interview, one book at a time. For me, I know that the past does not equal the future. I absolutely stand by that. That is my mantra. And I, with every day that I'm on this journey of seeking a better me and working on that better me, of dreaming who I want to be, and then turning this dream into a vision by being crystal clear who I want to be, and then turning that into a mission by actually taking active steps towards that direction. That is gold. That is a powerful thing. And by doing so, I'm reinventing myself. I get to live a day with new enthusiasm. I live every day with the knowledge that today I'm going to learn something new, and I'm looking forward to it. And there will be days when I'm actually waking up and I'm gonna feel and you've got this kind of and you're not feeling right. And there are days like that. And like yesterday, that was a day. It was a hard day yesterday morning. But I had put my habits into place, so I actually focused on those things that I can do something about. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change,
I love that
courage to
prayer.
change the things I can,
Yeah.
and wisdom to know the difference.
Amen.
So, yes, I was in a shit foul mood when I arrived at work. And then ha at work, things happened that I misinterpreted to further bring me into a bad mood. Later on, I had to realize, well, actually, much of that morning was all up to you because you woke up in that stinking mood. You actually heard things that were meant completely different. And but luckily I didn't respond to it. I didn't actually the fighter didn't come out. Rawr, the anger, the resentment. No. Instead I just focused, okay, hang on. You have to do a job here. And I focused on my job. And then I ticked off something else and ticked off something else. So I actually habitually worked on my self-worth. until that stinking thinking came down, and I actually felt a bit better. And a lot of coffee helped actually too. So I did all those things that I needed to do. I looked after my basics. I made sure that I actually took deep breaths and changed my state, my physical state, by doing that. I put on a mask, but the mask actually helps me to change my state. So I'll do power moves. Good old Tony Robbins, he's strong on that. These kind of if you're really down and you actually stand up, look up into the air, put a big smile on your face, and now try to be sad. It actually is really hard. It's really hard to be sad
Yeah,
when you're
I
taking
don't
power
really see
moves.
it as a mask. I see it as you're practicing what
That's
you want
right.
to become.
That's right. And it's
You're
beautiful.
practicing
That's
what you want to become. It's not
perfect.
fake. You're
Oh,
practicing it.
yeah.
You did the mask before when you were busy hiding and busy hiding and busy
Good.
hiding.
Love it.
You
Love
were
it.
practicing what you wanted to become. You were taking ownership of what you
Absolutely.
wanted to become instead of what you found yourself in.
Perfect. You, lovely said. Thank you. Thank you.
And we're running out
Because.
of time here. I don't want you
Oh!
to not be able to share your book. Please lift up your book, show our audience, tell us about your book and your
Right,
also you have your
okay.
own podcast
Right.
by the
That's
same
true.
name. Share with us your book a little bit.
That's right. So this is my steps to sobriety. Get sober and stay that way. This is my book where I really share my story and where I give you a rundown with lots of stories and lots of action plans, how I got clean. And basically I did that with a 12-step program. And it really worked for me. There are many other versions out there that can be of help, but hey, if you don't know where to start, it worked really well for me. So that is in my book. And then after the 12 steps, there are action plans for all those challenges that I mentioned. It's virtually a given that you will get a low mood at some stage. Well, what
We
do you
have
do
bad
about
days.
it?
Everyone wakes up and has a bad
Oh,
day. And then you
exactly.
have to own
But.
it, what you want to own going forward.
Well, exactly. What happens if your money runs out? Okay, so okay, let's talk about money actually in that book. Well, let's talk about toxic relationships, either at work or in your private spheres. So now those kind of things. So it's a very practical book from that angle, and no, I love it. And my show is Steps to Sobriety on YouTube and as a podcast. And in there, I bring on guests that have gone through hell and back, but kept going. So I want to learn from people either why they escaped their reality, they did. So if they were addicts, they used, then let's talk about that. And let's talk about the lessons that they learned. Often my guests have nothing to do with addiction. I've had concentration camp survivors. I had special forces soldiers who were talking about their problems, etc. So I bring on people where I think, damn, how did you get through that? And I actually listen to that. I explore with them. So that is an hour of therapy I get with every gorgeous person I bring onto my show. So check out my Steps to Sobriety. There's some amazing people I've interviewed, and there are some amazing people coming up. Today, as we speak, I've had a Pulitzer Prize nominated author on there, Clint Arthur, who is out there. Man, this guy has worked with five different presidents and has got all these pictures with all, the kind of stuff that you think, come on, that must be photoshoped. Nah.
Oh,
You
don't
know,
you
these kind
just
of
love that
guys.
you can dive into people's stories by doing podcasts.
It's
That's what I love. And
gorgeous,
getting
isn't
to
it?
meet you, and I got to interview a gentleman. He was one of the casting directors for Shawshank Redemption.
That's right, I had him too. Exactly.
Oh, you
Yeah,
did it.
exactly. Yes, I know. I know. How cool is that? But you get these beautiful people who are willing to make their mess a message. And that is our message, Danielle, and my message to you guys out there. The past does not equal the future.
Amen.
And whatever has happened in your past, you can turn that around, and you can make that your strength. You can make that your driving force by
Amen.
dealing with it and then saying, okay, I've dealt with all that shit. Is that all now? Or actually, do I want to go out and tell others about what happened to me and how I now deal with it and maybe be the light in the darkness for someone else.
Amen.
And who knows? Who knows? You might end up on a show like here, or you might write a book, or right. God knows. So one more little call to action. Jump over to www.mysstepstosobriety.com.
That's your website,
that's,
right?
That's my website.
My next thing, how can people connect? So you just there jump you right go. There for me.
There you go. Just jump there, because at the moment I'm looking for co-authors who are working with me on two books about depression, one for the girls, one for the boys, where we actually say, depression lied to me. And that is the title for the girls. Boys Don't Cry is the title for the boys. Both are working titles. They might change. But ultimately is I give others the chance to open up and actually explore their trauma. Wow. In the moment you put things in writing or put things into words, coming onto a show like here, wow, that's when the floodgates open. You will never be the same again, right. Because inevitably you will grow. So. Yeah. How beautiful is that? Ah, oh, gorgeous. I mean, Danielle, the work that you are doing by bringing a platform out there for people to come onto and share their stories, that is so powerful for the people who share it, for the people to listen to it.
Yeah.
Therefore, it's so beautiful. Thank you so much for being the person you are, the person who sends out love and who is there to give this virtual hug to the people who need it. So thank you so much for the work that you are doing.
Well, thank you. And thank you for being with us today. I just have enjoyed this immensely, and I would like to continue going on, but I know you have a hard stop. And so we will we'll reconvene in just a little bit. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you so much. And you guys out there, look after yourself.
Well, there you have it. I could go on and share so much more about Stephan. He has so much more to share. So hop over to his website, check him out, and see, you know, what fits you in your life so that you can be a victorious soul. And so until next time, this is Danielle Burnock from DanielleBurnock.com. Love yourself from Survive to Thrive, that lady on the internet who says I love you. Mwah. Says she loved you.